Hey, CrossPoint. We good? I like that. I like that. So, what's the deal with this eclipse thing happening tomorrow? Is it real? Is it going to happen? Really? Is anybody excited? I'm curious. Is anybody in town just for the eclipse? Right here in the front row? Are you serious? Where are you from? From Virginia, in town for the eclipse. Okay, so here's what we've done. We've thought ahead for you. We've got a solar eclipse starter kit. I've got a moon pie. I've got sun kiss. See what we did there? And because the glasses are hard to find, we actually did a little better. We got a soothing gel eye mask for you. It's literally the same thing. Like right before you put it on, everything goes dark, and then you take it off after, and it's great. Eclipse just happened. Come on up here. Get your starter kit. Give it up for our friend from Virginia. Welcome. We're glad you're here. And if you're new with us today, we're so glad you're here. My name is Drew. I get to serve as a creative arts pastor. We're going to have a fun day, week two of our movement series. So if you can, why don't you stand on your feet? I want to welcome everyone joining us online today. We're glad you're tuning in with us. So turn to someone, say welcome. Tell them to protect their retinas. We're so glad you're here. Welcome to CrossPoint.
Where goodness flows, there welcome to CrossPoint. My name is Mike. This is Cheryl. We're a couple of the worship leaders here. You guys, we still have some people coming in. So if you have some seats in the middle of the aisles, can you scoot in just to create some room as people are still coming in? I'm going to be real honest with you, and maybe you can relate. But there are moments in my life where I put God in these boxes. I kind of have the stuff that I trust him with, and then I have the box where I don't necessarily fully trust yet. And the thing I love about this next song is we think we have control, right? We think we have control of these boxes. But we have a God that regardless, you guys, he doesn't love us how we think we should be loved. He loves us how he knows we need to be loved. And sometimes that's like a hurricane. Sometimes that's like a tidal wave. That means we have no response but to just go with the flow because we don't have control. So Jesus, we invite you in this place today. God, we want to be overcome. We want to be overwhelmed by all of who you are. We want to give you those spots that we've held back. In your name. Found.
blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that again. My hope.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
We sing Christ alone,
Christ alone, a cornerstone, a weak made strong in the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Amen.
Darkness seems to hide His face. I'll rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale,
My anchor
holds within the veil.
Come on!
My anchor holds within the veil.
Sing it out.
Christ alone, cornerstone, the weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of
all. We sing Christ alone.
Come on. Cornerstone.
have your seat. Man, singing that this morning, just sitting down here, just reminded of how important it is, this time of worship is, when we come together and we sing these truths, like weak made strong in the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord of all. And I just hope that you are challenged and encouraged by those truths this morning. And again, if you are new with us and just came in, we just want to say welcome. We're glad you're here. We'd love the opportunity to get to know you a little bit. We've got a station in the lobby. It just says new here. There's a sign. You can stop by there. You can meet one of our volunteers. We'd just love to get to know you and get to know us. We've got a gift for you. Today's exciting because we get to give towards the Dollar Club. So if you don't know what the Dollar Club is, about once a month, we do this story. And what it does is it teaches us about generosity. It teaches us that if everyone just gives a little bit, we can do some really great stuff together. So today, if you normally give your tithes and offerings, just give $1 more. And this is a great on-ramp for some of you that haven't, that don't give. You can just give $1. And I know a lot of you don't carry cash, and so we've thought through that for you. Here's what we'd advise you to do. Just steal one from a kid, you know? Just take, they usually have a dollar, and see, it's easy come, easy go. They have a dollar, they'll give it to you, and you give to the Dollar Club. It's great. You teach them generosity, pay it forward. But next week, you'll want to come back because we'll have a just short film on how we got to do something really special together in our community. So I'd invite our greeters to come. Also, if you've been here the past couple weeks, we've been talking a lot about groups. We've been just really saying groups are important to us. And so today's one of the last days that you can sign up for a group, and we'd encourage you to do that. I was talking to a friend of mine this week, and he said, I was just asking, why is community important for you? And here's what she said. She said, Drew, I'm really glad that I didn't wait for life to happen before I invested into good biblical community. And she just went on to say, over the past couple years, I've had several, like four or five huge life events happen. There's a couple deaths, but just a couple big things happened. She said, I was so glad at that moment in time that I had a group of people that could come around me to love me, to support me through that. She said, I'm so glad I didn't wait until that happened to find community. And so the reason why we talk about it so much is it's something that we want for you. We believe in it for you. We believe that it's a great thing to invest in. And what we do on Sundays is so important, but it's lacking if we just leave here and we don't live life together. And so we want to encourage you to get involved. You can go to the website, crosspoint.tv/groups, and sign up. Or you can stop by the station in the lobby. You'll see green balloons, a bunch of volunteers in green shirts. And you can stop by there and sign up today. And we'd just love for you to get involved in that, okay? So we're excited because today is week two of our movement series. Last week, Pastor Kevin brought one of the best messages I've heard in a long time. He just talked about sometimes in order to move forward, the thing you got to do first is to go back to the last thing that Jesus asked you to do. And that's been living with me all week long. But today, we're just building on that idea. And so whether you're joining us here in the room in Nashville or whether you're joining us online, we want to say welcome to week two of Movement.
The foundational reality of our world is measured by movement. The existence of everything determined by time and distance and the shifting of reference and perspective therefrom. Nothing in this cosmos is ever truly at rest or even at a pause. Currents, waves, light, energy, all in motion, swirling up around us. We may choose to carry around the illusion of being at rest, but with the whole universe understood to be in motion, it seems we are unable to truly resist all forces. We're constantly propelled in some direction. So when we're found sitting idly by, will we allow a force greater than our complacency to act upon us? Or will we resist? Sensation rousing our spirits and shifting our orientation, this force comes in rhythms and waves. It has new iterations, phases, and categories every passing moment, but it simply cannot be stalled. It will not tolerate a stalemate. It is not a tremor. It is a groundswell. Where this force stirs, we must step. Where this force whispers, We must raise our voices, and where this force moves, we must start our movement.
Welcome to CrossPoint and week two of our series, Movement. And you want to know what a movement looks like? Let's look around Nashville this weekend. Hundreds of thousands of people converge, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people converge on the town, on the city to see this once-in-a-lifetime experience where the city and the cosmos align for a total solar eclipse. And so that's what a movement looks like. If you try to get on the interstate tomorrow, you won't see a movement. You'll see a stoppage. Everything's just going to shut down for a little while and celebrate and enjoy what's going on. In this series, we're talking about movement. We're talking about how God, the creator of the universe, that he wants to move in your life and through your life. And he's inviting you to be a part of a movement that's bigger than you. And to be a part of a movement that's bigger than you. And that's the invitation we're given in this series. We're going to pick up where we left off. We had Jesus resurrected from the dead on the beach, eating fish tacos with the boys. And so Jesus and the disciples sharing a meal, sharing conversations. So the disciples, they talk about the movement. They're like, Jesus, what's next? Like, what are we going to do now? That whole resurrection thing, that was awesome, Jesus. You just blew the Romans' minds. I mean, that was great. That was genius what you did. But what's the next move? What's the sequel to the resurrection? What are you going to do? And Jesus said, you want to know the sequel? You want to know what's next? Let's tap into the conversation. We find it in Acts chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. It says, on one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized you with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses to Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And so it's a conversation that Jesus had, and the disciples are like, well, what's next? And Jesus said, well, next I want you to go to Jerusalem. All right, we go to Jerusalem. Then what? And Jesus said, I want you to wait. Now, you think about it, Jesus has them all fired up. I mean, they're in the locker room. They're getting ready to rush out on the field, to run through the tunnel, and Jesus said, okay, but before you do, I want you to wait. Like, kind of a buzzkill for the moment. I mean, he had all this momentum going, and then Jesus said, I just want you to wait. And I was thinking, you know what, we hate to hear that, don't we? Like, we hate to hear the word wait. I'm convinced in our society, in our day, we are the worst waiters in human history. We don't want to wait for a pot of coffee, so in 30 seconds, we make Keurig. We don't want to wait in line at the grocery store, so we have self-checkout or we have the express lane. And express lane is 15 items or less. And we hate to wait behind people in the express lane, especially if they have more than 15. Just curious, how many of you, by show of hands, how many of you ever counted the items in the cart in front of you in the express lane? Okay, how many of you ever taken an item out if they're over the 15? But you thought about it. You did. You thought about doing that. And so we hate to wait in line at the stores, so we have Amazon Prime. And we hate to wait for two-day deliveries, so we have Prime Now. And we hate to wait for a book, and so we download it on our Kindle. And we hate to read the book. That takes too long. So we download it on Audible and we read it at two times the speed, you know. We hate to wait in traffic, and so that's why they install horns on our cars, right? And we hate to wait. We hate to wait for a letter to be mailed. That's why we send an email. We hate to wait for the email. That's why we send a text. And even when we send a text, we hate to wait, because one of these things shows up. And when the little three-dot cloud shows up, what that says is that the person on the other end of this text message, that they're cooking something up. And if you've ever seen this cloud, you know that something's coming your way. Now, I don't know of anything more depressing in life. Well, actually, there are other things, but I'm just saying, this is pretty depressing. When you sin, when you pour out your heart and you send this long text, and you know, you work hard, you cultivate it, you proofread it. Let's just say you're pouring out your heart to Bernice, and you're trying to define the relationship with Bernice. I don't know who Bernice is, but you know where I'm going. So there's a conversation going on. You put this big text together, and then you send it, and then you see the three-dot cloud. And so that other person is working something up, and then this happens. Like, well, what's going on? And then you're like, I don't know. Do I text back? Should I text back just to make sure? Or is that like too desperate? You know, you don't quite know how to respond. But then pretty much what you're left with is just wait. And I was thinking, you know, that's what a lot of life is. Just in every day, it's waiting. And we hate the waiting. But then there's a much more serious kind of waiting. There's actually a much more, I guess you could say, agonizing, gut-wrenching kind of waiting that goes on in life. It's waiting for a job. And waiting to see if you get into grad school. Or maybe it's waiting to see if marriage is in God's plan for you and in your future. Or maybe it's waiting to see, maybe you are married and it's waiting to see if the other person's going to change or if things will have a breakthrough. Maybe it's waiting for a child. Maybe we didn't get pregnant. Maybe you're joining us from God Behind Bars and it's waiting for parole. Or maybe it's waiting to see if you'll get the promotion or if you'll get the break or if you'll get the deal. Or maybe it's waiting to see if you'll get the house or if you'll get the health or maybe the help that you need. There's a much more serious kind of waiting, and I venture to say that every one of us has something that we're waiting on, something that we're waiting for. Now, we all have these places and spaces in our lives where we're needing movement, where we're asking God to move, where we're begging God to move, where we're wanting God to move in our lives. And the waiting is the hard work of faith. And it's in those waiting seasons that I want to speak into that today. Because when we look throughout the scriptures, what we find is that waiting always precedes a move of God. Before there's a move of God, there's waiting on God, there's waiting for God. That waiting always precedes the move of God. And usually before God does something powerful and something amazing and something wonderful and something significant, he calls his people to wait first. See, we look at waiting in life as a setback, but through scriptures we see it's a setup. That waiting is a setup for God to do something in a way that only he can get the credit and only he can get the glory. I mean, when you read through the scriptures, you find that waiting is our story as the people of God. I mean, it goes all the way back to beginning. In Genesis, in the beginning, God creates Adam, and he breathes the breath of life into Adam's nostrils. And Adam awakens, and he's alive. And what's interesting next is that God gives Adam a job. He says, I want you to name all the animals, which means that God didn't create Eve instantly, which means that Adam had to wait. And I love how Donald Miller gives commentary to this. Here's what he writes. He said, God made Adam wait before he created Eve so that when he finally received her, he would love her and cherish her and have the utmost appreciation, respect, and gratitude for her. And waiting began with Adam, and we've been waiting all along. You find Abraham waited 24 years before he became a father, before he had a child. Joseph waited 13 years in prison before he was in the palace. People of God, the nation of Israel, waited 40 years in the wilderness before they inherited the promised land. David waited 15 years. He had the anointing, but he waited 15 years for the crown. Israel waited generation after generation after generation for a Savior. And then 2,000 years ago, God sent his son Jesus to be the Savior, to be the Messiah, to save us. And then Jesus waited 30 years in obscurity for 3 years of ministry. They crucified him. He laid down his life on the cross, and he waited 3 days to rise from the dead. Waiting is a part of our story. Here's what I figured out, is that we have a God who's much more comfortable with waiting than we are. And that God has been calling people to wait. Very rarely in Scripture do we see that a mighty move of God, God doing something amazing in the earth, that it begins with a human agenda and a human timetable. Oftentimes, God will call people to wait, and waiting, biblically, waiting, we look at it as a setback, but God sees it as a setup. And Jesus tells the disciples, all right, here's what I want you to do. You ready? I want you to go to Jerusalem, and I want you to wait. Because what he says is that you are waiting for the Holy Spirit. He said, the Father has promised he will send the Spirit. I will send my Spirit to dwell in you, to live in you, to empower you, because there is a purpose for your life that's greater than you. And in order to accomplish a purpose that's greater than you, you're going to need a power that's more than what you've got in the tank. And so I'm going to empower you with my Spirit so you can fulfill my purpose. And I think the reason Jesus did it this way is because he wants to, I want to do something with your life that's greater than can be explained by your ingenuity, by your creativity, by your network, or by your net worth. I want to do something through your life that's greater than can be explained with what you have in your own strength. I want a movement. I want to invite you to be a part of a movement that's greater than anything you have on your own. And so Jesus said, I will give the Holy Spirit, but before I send the Holy Spirit, I want you to wait. And I find it interesting, he didn't tell them how long they were going to be waiting. He just said, he didn't give them like a little timetable, you know, like a little, you know, kind of calendar of saying this is how long. Jesus didn't. He just told them, I want you to wait. And sociologists have told us that when we don't know how long we're going to wait, that it adds to the uncertainty, adds to the stress of waiting. This is why at Disney, they give you an estimated wait time in line. This is why when you're in a lobby, it tells you what floor the elevator is on. This is why when you're on the tarmac, the captain comes over and says, it's only going to be 3 more hours. But it's okay because you can have a pack of pretzels and a Coke Zero, and that will make up for 3 hours. No. And so we know that when we're uncertain about how long we're going to wait, that it just adds to it. I remember meeting Sean because the boys wrestled together, and he said that he was waiting on a heart. His heart was operating at 20%, and the doctors had given him a vest that would literally shock him back to life. He had to wear it every day, but it would shock him back to life if his heart quit on him at 20%. And he carried around a beeper that would let him know when a transplant was ready. And every day he put that on as the equipment reminding him that he was waiting. And when you don't know how long you're waiting for, it adds to the stress of the waiting. And we're all in a waiting season. Maybe right now you're waiting for some test results to come back on a biopsy. Or maybe you're waiting on a procedure. Or maybe you're waiting on a job, or you're waiting on a person to change, or on circumstances to change. Maybe you're waiting on the Titans to win the Super Bowl, and we don't know how long. I did get to go to my first Titans game yesterday, so you're working on me, Tennessee. You're working on me, and we don't know how long we're going to be waiting, but what waiting is, and what God wants to know in the waiting, he wants to know, will you trust me in this? Will you trust me, even when you don't know how long you're going to be waiting, will you trust that I love you? Would you trust that I'm with you? Would you trust that I'm working, even when you can't see me working? Would you trust that I am for your good, and I am for my glory? And would you trust me that I'm present, and that I'm with you, and that I'm working, even when you can't see it? Because waiting involves trusting. And the question that comes up is like, why would God call us to wait? I mean, when he has all the resources, when he has all the answers, when God has all of the power, why would he call us as humans to wait? And I don't know all of the reasons that God has you waiting right now. But I know that one reason that really resonates with me in the things that I'm waiting for comes from author John Ortberg. I want to put it up on the screen. I put it in your notes so you can take it home with you. It's a great thought. It says, what God does in us while we wait is as important as what we're waiting for. Let's get that one more time. What God does in us while we wait is as important as what we're waiting for. Biblically, waiting is not just something that we do to get what we want. Biblically, waiting is something that God does, that God uses in our lives as a process to build the things in our lives that he can't build any other way. See, waiting is part of our formation, and it's in the waiting that we develop trust. It's in the waiting that God builds gratitude. It's in the waiting that we learn humility. It's in the waiting that we grow in worship. It's in the waiting that we learn how to pray. It's in the waiting that we become more like Christ. It's in the waiting that God builds substance to the soul. It's in the waiting that God builds character. See, I can promise you this, whatever you're waiting for, God will not waste the waiting. He's not wasting your waiting. And as painful and as difficult, as hard as it is, he's not wasting the waiting. And what God does in the waiting is as important as what you're waiting for. And so I wish I could go through all of those things that God does in the waiting. I want to talk about a few things that God does in the waiting. And the first one is this. It's actually two things. The first two things are this. In waiting, God grows us in worship, and he teaches us how to pray. In the waiting, God grows us in worship, and he teaches us how to pray. Let me show you a couple scriptures from the text. Tell us about what did the disciples do after Jesus said, I want you to go back to Jerusalem and I want you to wait. What did they do in Jerusalem? It says, well, they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they stayed continually at the temple praising God. And what this other scripture gives us another detail as to what they did when they gathered together. It said they all joined together constantly in prayer along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. So what this is telling us is that when they got together, they prayed and they worshiped. That's what they did in the waiting. They didn't know how long they would be waiting, but they prayed and they worshiped. And I found in my own life that God uses the waiting seasons of my life to grow me in worship and to grow me in prayer. And prayer is not just when we come to God with our laundry list of things that we want. Prayer is a relationship. That's what God wants most with you. He wants a relationship. And so in prayer, we're working on this relationship and we're putting our desperation on God. We're giving our desperation to God because you realize this, that if you don't give your desperation to God, if you don't cast your desperation on God, you're going to put your desperate on other people. And God is the only one in the universe who's attracted to desperate. God wants your desperation. God answers desperate prayers. God wants you to put your desperation on him so you don't bring your desperation to everybody around you. Because if you bring your desperation to other people around you, you're going to... suck the life out of them. But if you bring your desperation to God, he will breathe life into you. And prayer is learning how to exhale our desperation on God and how to inhale the strength that he gives. Prayer is giving our desperation is language of the kingdom. And I said, will you give me your desperate prayers? Will you bring your desperation to me so you don't have to put it on everybody else? It's in the season of waiting that God teaches us how to worship. Worship is not just something that we do as an activity on the weekends. Worship is a part of life. It's turning our affection to God. It's giving our attention to God. It's making him much in our lives. And one of the ways we worship is with singing. And what happens when we sing is we turn our attention to him rather than the other things. Because what happens when we're waiting for something, what can happen is worry and anxiety can set in and it can overwhelm us. And we can be overwhelmed with our anxiety. But what happens in worship is that worship overwhelms the worry. And the presence of God and the acknowledgement, the awareness of his presence overwhelms the thing that's overwhelming you. And you find that there is one who is greater than the thing that you're waiting for. And so what happens in worship is that God begins to work in us. And so I want to invite you to an experiment this week. I want to invite you to take one of the songs that we sang today or take one of the songs from the worship set. We'll put the names of the songs on the screen and you can just write that down. And I want you to go on iTunes or go on Spotify or go on MySpace Music and go find... we're going to have a special prayer time for people who still use MySpace Music, but... And so go and download the song, like make it a part of your week. And so when you're driving down the road and you're sitting in traffic tomorrow and you're sitting in a lot of traffic, like have your own moment with God. Like bring worship into your week, put it in your headphones. When you're on the treadmill and you're running, you start just singing that song. When you're in the shower, sing that song. When you're driving down the road, make it part of the soundtrack of your life. And here's what will happen. You'll come to worship on the weekend and you hear that song come on. You're like, that's my jam. And so then that's your song. Why? Because you have history with that song. See, worship's not just something for the weekend, it's a part of life. And what we find in the waiting, that it's primary territory for God to begin to make us into a person who worships because we find that he is greater than the thing that we're waiting on. And even while we're waiting, God's doing a work in us. God uses the waiting seasons to build prayer and worship, to grow us in that, to grow us in that relationship with him because that's what it's all about. It's all about the relationship. And see, when the Bible says, wait upon the Lord, It's not some passive thing. It's a confident, expectant, hopeful thing. It's a clinging to, sometimes painful clinging to God and say, God, even though right now my life doesn't look like what I thought it was going to look like, and even though right now I realize that it may never look like what I thought it was going to look like, I'm going to cling to you. I'm going to hold to you. God, I'm going to hold tight to you. I'm going to trust you. See, waiting is an act of trust. Say, God, I'm going to trust you in the present. I'm going to hold to you. I'm going to wait on you. And I just want to take a moment to commend you, CrossPoint, for the way that you've waited over the past 10 months in the search for a pastor. You, the congregation, the elders, the board, the staff, the way that you have waited and the way that you've held on to him, the way that you've trusted him. And it's been encouraging and inspiring to see that the way that you've waited. It's been remarkable to see what God did over those 10 months. The first person I ever met from CrossPoint, it was the week after it was announced that I'd be coming on as pastor. I was down in Florida on vacation with my family, and my son Bolton and I, we went to the market to go get a muffin. And so we were riding bikes, and somebody waved me down on the bike. They said, Pastor Kevin. And I said, I go to CrossPoint. I actually have a picture here. This is AJ. And I took a picture because I was like, this is the first person I met from CrossPoint. I'd never stepped foot at CrossPoint on a service on a weekend, but I met AJ. And AJ said, look, I go to CrossPoint, and I've been going to CrossPoint for 3 weeks. I said, you've been going for 3 weeks? He's like, yeah, I've just started going to CrossPoint. And I'm glad I took that picture because it was a reminder to me that even in the 10 months, as you were waiting as a church, God was working. It's been remarkable how many people that I've met, like AJ, that came into CrossPoint over the 10 months while CrossPoint was searching for a senior pastor. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to borrow faith from that. Because there's a place in your life where you're waiting and where you're working and you're holding and you're clinging and you're saying, God, would you come through in this? God, I'm praying for this. I'm begging. I'm asking for this. I'm putting my desperation on you. And God's saying, know that even though you're not at the conclusion, I'm still working. God's still working. And there are many things. Listen, just like that quote, what God does in us while we wait is as important as what we're waiting for. There are things that God's done in the waiting of the past 10 months that he's taught you as a church. He's taught you that the church is not the pastor, that the church is not the place, that the church is not the performance, that the church is not an event, that the church is not a service, that the church is the people. The church is the people of God who are carrying out the mission of God so that the people of this city and the people of the world would know that Jesus is the only hope for the human heart. And so you have learned and you have sought him in that, and God was working even as you're waiting, and the same is true in your life. That even that thing that you're waiting for, God is working. And so in the working, God teaches us how to hold to him, how to trust in him. But then God also teaches us character. He teaches us character. In the waiting, God builds character in us. Those of you who are parents, let me ask you a question. What would it do to your child if you gave them everything they want when they want it? They would be ungrateful. It would crush their soul because they don't have the maturity to handle the blessing of what they want. And they would live with a sense of entitlement. And so there's a child psychologist, Dan Allender, and here's what he says, parents, it's your job to answer two questions. Your primary job is to answer two questions for your child. The first one is, am I loved unconditionally? And the second question that your child has is, can I have everything I want when I want it? He says, your job as a parent is to answer those two questions. The first one is, yes, you are loved unconditionally. The second is, no, you cannot have everything you want when you want it. And see, we get that as parents, that it takes time for there to build maturity for us to be able to handle the blessing, and that God is working and he's building character in us. D. Martin Lloyd-Jones said it this way. He said, the worst thing that can happen to a man or a woman is that they succeed before they're ready. And oftentimes God is withholding things in our lives because he knows that the blessing would crush us. And he's building character underneath. And we don't like to wait. But a signature of maturity on a person's life is their ability to wait. Some Stanford psychologists did a test with this. They did a test back in the 60s called the marshmallow test. And what they did was they got a bunch of, it was a controlled test. They got a bunch of four-year-olds. I know controlled test and bunch of does not quite go together for academic research, but they got a bunch of them, and they pulled them together. And they one at a time, they put them in this room, and they took a marshmallow, and they put it on a plate. And then they asked the kids, they said, we're going to leave you in this room. They told them, we're going to leave you in this room, and you've got a choice. You can either eat that marshmallow that's in front of you, or you can wait. And if you wait until we return, we'll give you two marshmallows. And so they put it right there in front of them. The kids had a choice to make. And then they wrote down, you know, what kids were kind of the grab the marshmallow now kind of kids, and what kids were the wait for two marshmallow kids. And they tracked those kids over 25 years. So 25 years later, it's remarkable what they discovered. Listen to this. Here's what the experiment predicted. Those who said no to self and those who waited for the second marshmallow at age 4 grew up more socially competent, more confident, able to make better decisions. They had higher self-esteem. They had higher SATs. They earned more and were more able to persist than the grab the marshmallow now kids. The boys who grabbed the marshmallow were more likely to end up in jail, and the girls with teenage pregnancy. Now, when I came across this study, I thought, that's fascinating. And then I thought, I have a 4-year-old. I wonder what my 4-year-old would do, which was a horrible idea. And so I don't know how, but I convinced my wife, like, I talked with Ree, and I was like, Ree, we could do this. And we just happened to be that day, we happened to be at my mother-in-law's house. I asked my mother-in-law, I was like, do you have marshmallows? She said, yes, I have marshmallows. I was like, it's a sign, we should do this. And so I got my 4-year-old at the time, Bolton, who's now 8, and I put upstairs in a room, and I made a controlled environment, and I put the marshmallow and I took my iPhone, and I set it over in the corner, and I recorded what happened. And then I stepped outside with my wife. And as we're standing outside, I'm going, this is the worst thing ever. Because, like, his whole life is about to, you know, be before us. We're going to know the way the end of the story goes right here. This is it. And so we recorded it. You want to see what happened? All right, check us out.
Do you like marshmallows?
Yes.
Okay, on your plate is a marshmallow. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what's going to happen. You can eat that marshmallow, or you can wait 5 minutes. And after 5 minutes, we'll come back. And if you wait 5 minutes and don't eat the marshmallow, we'll give you 2 marshmallows.
Okay.
Do you want 1 marshmallow or 2 marshmallows?
2.
Okay. So we're going to leave you in here, and we'll see what you do, okay?
Hey.
Did you eat it?
No.
It's still there. You want two?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, I was so relieved to see that marshmallow. I was like, you want 2? I'll give you 6 marshmallows. I'll give you the whole bag. Just something. Did you notice what he did? He disappeared. He got under the table. All right. Because as a 4-year-old, he understood, I'm less likely to eat the marshmallow if I'm staring at the marshmallow. So let me not look at the marshmallow. As 40-year-olds, we could learn from a 4-year-old. Yeah. That there are things that we're tempted by in life, and that God says, I want you to wait, and I want you to trust me, and we're just going, if I just get under. Listen, we live in a culture that says, grab the marshmallow now. Like, do whatever you want. You don't have to wait. Just whatever you want right now, hashtag YOLO. Which is a stupid way to live. I mean, it really is. Like, so really what we're saying is just don't worry about future consequences of anything. Just live right now for the moment. But what Bolton learned in a lesson that I think is true for all of us, I believe, that God rewards, that the Father rewards the waiting. And God blesses us in the waiting. But here's where the whole thing breaks down, is that you're not alone in the waiting. See, I stepped outside of the room, but your Father wants you to know that he's given you a spirit. See, the disciples did what Bolton did. They got on their face and they waited for the Holy Spirit, waited for the gift, but the gift has already come. And God's spirit dwells in you. If you're a follower of Jesus, the spirit of God is in you. And what he wants to do today is he wants to give you courage, and he wants to give you strength, and he wants to give you peace in the waiting, that you would know that what he's doing in the waiting is as important as what you're waiting for. And realize that there are all different kinds of things that we're waiting for in life, but that God wants to meet us in the waiting, that we're not alone in the waiting. So whether you're at one of the campuses or whether you're joining us online, I want you to get the card in your hands that you were handed when you came in the doors. It was distributed. I want you to look at the scripture. We're just going to reinforce this idea with a scripture and with a song. This verse from Psalm 27:14 says, "Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord." Your Father always makes good on His promises. Your Heavenly Father, your earthly Father may have dropped some promises, but you need to know this, that your Heavenly Father is the perfection of everything you've ever longed for in a Father. And that His promises are fulfilled. And wherever you're waiting, to let this be a verse that reminds you to hold tight and to take courage today. Maybe a response for you today would be to flip this over and just write on the back, just write a prayer. God, teach me how to pray. Would you write a prayer on the back of what you're praying for, what you're asking God for? Maybe that's time for you to do that later on. But then to take this scripture and to place it on the dashboard or to place it on the mirror in the bathroom or to put it on the refrigerator, to put it somewhere where it would, on your desk, on your computer, where it would be a reminder to you that even while you're waiting, God is still working and that there's courage for your heart. And we're going to reinforce this with a song in a moment, but before we do, I'd love to pray with you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you are working. You're working in our hearts and you're working in our lives, and that we want your movement. We want to be a part of your movement. We want you to move in us. We want you to move through us. God, oftentimes that requires that we wait. So I pray that today that you would give us patience and that you would give us perseverance, and that perseverance would build character and that character would build hope. And we know that hope does not disappoint. So I pray that you'd help us trust you in that. God, I pray for those today who are desperate, that they would put their desperation on you. Say, God, I'm trusting you. Even though I don't like how things look right now, I'm trusting you. I'm waiting on you. That today you would meet them with your presence, that you would meet them with your peace, that you would meet them with your strength, and today they would take courage, that they would take heart, that they would see you move in a way that only you can get the glory from, only you can get the credit, that you would write a story, that you've given the strength and the waiting, we pray.
He's in the waiting. encourage those of you who are not on your feet to take this chance to stand and to declare this over your life for whatever season that you're in now, whatever you're waiting in, He will meet you there. So take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting. Sing it out. He's in the waiting. And hold on to your hope. Watch your triumph unfold. He's never failing, God. He's never failing. So take courage, church. So take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting, yeah. He's in the waiting. And hold on to your hope. Watch your triumph unfold. He's never failing. He's never failing. He's in the waiting. He's in the waiting.
I want to pray for us before we go, but I pray that your heart is encouraged, that you find hope in this message today. Again, we'd love for you to take this card. Just let this scripture just be a reminder to you this week. The times where you need to know that God is with you. He's for you. He's with us in the waiting. We pray together. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for this word that we heard today. God, thank you for what you're doing in our hearts right now. And God, thank you that we can trust you, as Kevin said, because you're trustworthy. God, that you are with us in the waiting. God, for the moments that we feel anxious, we try to hurry through things. God, I pray that you would help us to trust your timing. That you're a good dad that loves us, wants the best for us. And it's your name we pray. Amen. Amen. So this week we talked about waiting on God. Next week we're going to talk about when and how do we know when God is actually waiting on us. And so we'd love for you to be back for that. We love you guys. Have a great week. Looking at my years like a martyrdom. Everybody needs to be a part of them. Never be enough. I'm the prodigal son. I was born to run. I was born for this.